This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network. I'm not afraid. I'm
not afraid to take a stand. Z Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Royal Fidelity Bank and Trust, Royal Star Assurance, Fidelity Bank Bahamas, the Water and Sewage Corporation, BTC, and the Cleveland Clinic.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. I trust that you had a great weekend, the one where we cruised you into the weekend with that relaxing music, and that your day so far, your week so far has been fantastic. If you want to give us a call, the numbers to do so are 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316 or 325-4259, 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796 or 439-3043. That's 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show. You can catch us on BTC Flow channel 612. That's BTC Flow channel 612. So the Central Bank of the Bahamas has indicated that the Bahamas does have a fair amount of assets booked with in the country that is tied to Russian or Russian interest, and that therefore it had indicated prior to that that institutions in the country ought to have limited any business being done with Russian, with sanctioned Russian entities. And I think that that's the important thing that we have to be aware of. It would be wrong to believe that because something is tied to Russia or Russian interest, that it is by virtue of that designation, something that's wrong, something that's not permissible, et cetera. That is not true, right? If you read the Central Bank's press release, it says on the 12th March, 2022, the group of financial services regulators, so the Bahamas has a group, the way it tries to coordinate the regulatory functions for the financial institutions in the country is the Central Bank, which has responsibility for banks and trust companies, credit unions, then the Securities Commission, which has responsibility for a wide segment of financial services providers outside of banks and trust companies and the like, the Registrar of Insurance, which has responsibility for the insurance companies and domestic and external, and they all collectively work as a group to try to make sure they can eliminate some of the replications of information from people and so forth. So for, so that is a more efficient way of doing it. So they call that the group of financial services regulators. There might be others in that group, but you know, the main ones are the central bank, the ORG, I mean, the Registrar of Insurance Companies, and then the Securities Commission. There is another one, I'm sure. I'll get it in a little while. Anyway, so that group issued a directive to Bahamian financial institutions against doing business. Listen to what it says now, and I quote, sanctioned persons and entities of Russia and Belarus. Sanctioned. So it's not every Russian interest, not every Russian person, not every Russian entity. It's the sanctioned one. And so they would have to get the list from the sanctioned one. It's sanctioned by whom? Well, if, you know, individual countries sanctioned them, so it's the United States of America. I don't know that the United Nations sanctioned them, but they may have. The United Nations may have. But anyway, they are sanctioned. So who did the sanctioning, then that's the list that you get. And you then, your institutions then have to check, do I have any business interests from those sanctioned persons or entities? And therefore, you now have to decide what you do about that. Anyways, the central bank said, since that time, they have been getting inquiries from the press about the amount of Russian business in the jurisdiction. Now, notice now, they said they're getting inquiries from the press. So in an attempt to respond to the press, the central bank then delivers some information. But notice what the press asked. The press did not ask the central bank, what is the amount of Russian business, of sanctioned Russian business in the jurisdictions, banks and trust companies? That's not what they asked. They asked, according to the press release from the central bank, they asked, what is the amount of Russian business in the jurisdictions, banks and trust companies? Okay, they didn't even say securities companies. They didn't even say financial service providers. They didn't even say credit unions. They didn't say anything like that. They just said that they were asked about in the jurisdictions, banks, and trust companies. And again, they didn't limit it to sanctioned Russian entities and persons. So the central bank says, as an extension of its regular surveillance, the central bank has gathered data from international banks and trust companies on their level of Russian business activities. Now, again, this is not sanctioned Russian business activities. This is Russian business activities. And said that the results of this exercise indicated that as at 28th February 2022, the sector held approximately US $420 million. Now, let me explain something to you. This is not in your commercial banks, right? Because we'll get to that later on. This is not in your commercial banking system. This is in your, pretty much in your private banking system in the country, the private banking system. Because private banks do not do public business with the general public. They do not. They do business with a sophisticated group of clients personal to their bank. So a private bank doesn't put itself out there and say, oh, you have a deposit, I'll take it. You want a loan, I'll give it. That's not what they do. There are private individuals who are high net worth individuals for the most part, who meet a certain criteria for wealth status that they do banking business for. And so these people would put on deposit in those private banks these monies. And so that's what they mean here for the most part, that $420 million is in deposit. That has nothing to do with your particular commercial banking sector's liquidity, folk. Nothing. All right. Most of that money isn't even here. While it's booked on the books here, that money is all over the place, right? Some of it might still be here. And then it says $2.5 billion is in custody or trust assets, okay? So let's talk about that for a moment. One of the things that the Bahamas' financial services sector is most popularly known for is the instrument of trust. A trust. And what's a trust? So you're a wealthy person. You got, let's say, $1 billion in assets. Well, here's the thing about $1 billion in assets. If somebody feels like you have done something to them, they can sue you. And as long as you own and hold those assets, well, those assets are liable for touching when the suit is done or is won. So what the Bahamas has a legal framework to do is this. The Bahamas can literally allow a person to separate what they call, what we call legal ownership, where in law you own a thing, from beneficial ownership, which is benefiting from something that you don't legally own. So you can separate those two ownerships. You could say, no, they own something legally, but the benefits that come from that thing, if it's invested, goes to those people over there. All right. So what these rich people do is they come to an institution in the Bahamas and they say, listen, I want to set up a trust in which I transfer the legal ownership of this $1 billion to you. And by virtue of a trust agreement that I set up with you, you can only use those assets, though you legally own it, for my benefit. So you are the trust institution is the legal ownership of the asset, but me, the settlor, that's what they call me, who's entrusted these assets, the settlor, I am the beneficial ownership owner, meaning I will benefit from the investment of that asset and so forth, right? And so the trustee is the one I made the legal owner of the asset, but I am the settlor, the beneficial owner, or somebody else I designate as the beneficial owner. And all of this is described in what we call a trust deed. And there are many types of trust deeds, right? They're revocable, irrevocable. You know what I mean? There's a different variety of them, right? And so our laws allow that to happen. And it's very popular, right? And it has some rules attached to it. Like once you establish that trust, you can't go around directing the trustee about what to do with the asset. Because if you're directing the trustee about what to do with the asset, then you can establish legal ownership of that asset again, which can make it subject to law, suits, and what have you, right? So you can only give instructions to the trustee through the trustee that you signed on the establishment of the trust. So when they say that there's $2.5 billion in custody or trust assets, that's what they're talking about. That these persons have created these trust deeds that included these assets in the trust deed. And these are Russian or Russian interests that are part of that scenario. And that's $2.5 billion. We got like $200+ billion of such kinds of arrangements in the Bahamas. So this is a small segment of that market that we're talking about. And again, this is not all sanctioned. This is not all sanctioned, right? In fact, nobody said any of this is sanctioned. This is just the total of the sum the central bank was able to gather the data on in respect of what was requested of the central bank. Right now, those assets aren't here. Those assets could be buildings in Europe, in Asia, in the United States. Those assets could be gold bullions held in some other place in the world. So it's just the trustee that has them booked here. All right. So I know how some of us are. We're running around, oh, we people ain't paying people poor and all this money in the banks. Come on. That's not the way the financial sector works. It is not the way that it works. These monies, many of these people's assets are invested in bonds and securities and, you know, in sophisticated securities instruments, maybe in some precious metal or these kinds of things, right? That's the way they do it. Most wealthy people do not keep an abundance of cash on hand. They do not. That's not a good investment strategy. So they don't do it, right? Because every day you hold the money in cash, inflation is deteriorating the value of the money. So people try to put their money in appreciating assets, artwork, lands in certain places and stuff like that, right? And so that's what the central bank is referring to. Again, how much of that relates to sanctioned persons or entities, we do not know. They did not say. That wasn't what they were asked for by the press. The press just asked them for the amount of Russian business in the jurisdiction's banks and trust companies. And I imagine that the press asked them that because they're trying to get a sense of the size of Russian interest in the Bahamas, right? Again, this is paper interest. They're not actual asset interest in the country. They're not buildings. There's not an abundance of cash and securities. They are basically book here. And, so some of them, the custody, for custody purposes, what you're talking about is if you transfer assets from one place to the next, even if you're doing like a securities trade or something like that, you if you have them on a market, you literally have to take, if you have them in a, you have to take custody of them so that in point of fact, they are within your control. And that's what we mean by custody in that way, okay? So the central bank says the greatest proportion of the Russian exposure would be linked to the international sector, as I indicated. So this says, however, the central bank is currently canvassing domestic financial institutions, that is the commercial banks, money transmission business, and electronic money service providers to ascertain any level of exposure within those sectors. So we don't know if there's any Russian exposure within the domestic banking sector, and that is according to the central bank of the Bahamas. So, why does the Bahamas have to be bothered with this at all? Why does the Bahamas have to take a position or not? Or why does it matter if we do or we do not? We'll talk about that when we come back from the break. You're listening to Z-Line. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand.
Warden's Roof Corporation advises its customers in New Providence and the Family Islands that the corporation will commence mass disconnections beginning Monday, March 28, 2022, on all outstanding accounts and financial agreements. Customers who have not honored their financial agreements are advised to visit their local offices to update those agreements as soon as possible. And all customers are further advised to bring their accounts up to date to avoid the disconnection of their water and sewage services without further notice.
Five-time defending Carifta swimming champions Team Bahamas is headed to Barbados April 16th through 20th for the Carifta Swimming Championships. Show your support in Bahamas by placing an ad in the Nassau Guardian Special Carifta Swimming Championship section, which will be published on April 4th. This is your chance to congratulate Team Bahamas, the coaches, or an individual swimmer in their quest for a sixth title. For more information, call your Nassau Guardian account executive now at 302-2300, 302-2300, and get your message in our special swimming championship section. Get ready for the 2022 Carifta Swimming Championships and Team Bahamas going for gold again.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF. Money at work.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
I'm not afraid.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. You can call us at 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. So we're talking a bit about the Russian interest in the country, especially in light of the war taking place between Russia and Ukraine. You'd think like taking place between Russia and Ukraine, those are two bordering countries. Ukraine used to belong to the Soviet Union at one point, and when that disintegrated, then Ukraine went off on their own, and as did other Soviet states. In the Warsaw Pact. But you think that being where they are so removed from us, like this wouldn't matter. I mean, why should it? Why should it matter to us? Maybe the US even, and there are people who argue that even the US interest should not be impacted by what Russia does in Ukraine. There are Americans who argue that, American scholars who argue that. Most of them are right-wingers, but they argue that. Right. And so it wouldn't be unusual and strange for Bahamians to argue, what the heck does that have to do with us? Why should we bother? You know, what does that have to do with us? Well, here's the thing. In a very real sense, it shouldn't matter to us. But here's the thing, right? When you have a sector of your economy, two for that matter, that are heavily tied to the international economy, heavily tied, okay? So you see tourists moving up and down. You see banking people flying in and out. You see wealthy persons going to Albany and these other places. And you see all of this happening. And that's the tangible, physical movements and transactions that you see. Well, the reality is, though, that undergirding all of that, behind all of that, supporting all of that, is movement of currencies, is financial transactions, is digits popping up on this account, popping up on that account, represented by this amount, represented by that amount, starting out in Russia, ending up in London, ending up in New York, ending up in Nassau, ending up in Poland. And it's like happening like in the trillions every day to support all this activity of movement, of travel, of buying and selling that we see happening in the world. It is all undergirded by a very integrated financial system. It's the network is so immensely intense that you have no idea how intensely integrated it is. Intensely integrated. Somebody's heartbeat in China, in Hong Kong, could very well impact somebody's heartbeat in New York City in a second. And much of the ease and comfort that we in the Bahamas enjoy in the way of our buying and selling from abroad and to abroad and all this kind of stuff is an ease and comfort that is facilitated by third-party institutions, not in the Bahamas, but outside of the Bahamas, with whom our institutions in the Bahamas have to do business. These trust companies and others who have to invest assets that provided to them and so forth, do so through the auspices of US markets and European markets and the like. All that integration means you don't have the luxury of burying your head in the sand and pretending don't make no difference to me what I do. Because on top of the undergirding of the integrated financial system, there is the integrated political system. Okay, let me tell you something. The international political system, people's eyes are open. And you know what they're watching for? They're watching for who's a foe and who's a friend. And you say, but that's petty. It ain't petty. That's called survival. Because if you don't know who your enemies are and you don't know who your friends are and you get them mixed up, dog could eat your lunch. That's the whole business of spying. You all realize the whole business of spying is trying to confuse who friends and foes are so that you, your foes think you're your friends and your friends think you're your foes so that when you shank them, nobody expected it, because that's the best way to deal with somebody is to not let them know what you're doing so that you could shank them and they don't have their guard set up against you. The whole notion of security surveillance is based on trying to know in advance, because you know the people who are trying to shank you are sneaking behind your back to shank you. And so you try to get intelligence to see where they're moving and going and saying before they get there. So in the international marketplace, diplomacy and all this, all they're doing all day long is watching who's a friend and who's a foe. And now you tell them who your friends and who your foe, not by the words they use, but by the actions they take. People talk to you all day long, child, you know I like you, child, you know I like you, and they all around way up stabbing you in the back. All around the place stabbing you in the back, but they like you, they like, oh, I love you, I love you, love you. Nonsense, how you love the people, them stabbing them in the back, talking bad with them all day long. Love who? Love what? Deceiving them, that ain't love. Right? I mean, you might love them, but it ain't showing very strongly. You might be angry and your love might be overwhelmed by your anger. And so your behavior is what is damaging the person, not your words. Even though your words could do it too. So every day when things happen, when events happen in the world that make people or suggest that you must take a side, you better believe your friends and your foes are watching to see what did you do. And choosing no side is choosing a side. Right? I mean, it might be looked at as a qualitatively different, but it is also looked at in terms of you didn't support me or you didn't work against my enemy. And so I therefore have a view of you. Right? So Little Bahamas, it ain't so little in relation to the global financial system that looks at its offshore center and says, it's pretty significant in the global scheme of things when we think about the kinds of persons and entities who might have monies or assets passing through it. And so they watch you and they observe you. What did you do when Russia attacked Ukraine and people started to sanction them? What did you do? Now you have a legitimate decision to make. You could decide I do nothing, or you could decide I do something, right? But to believe that either decision leaves you without consequences is to be foolhardy. Now, I'm not going to tell you what the consequences are because I don't know what your enemies and your friends are going to do. But to be sure, in the world of international politics, people lock things in on deposit. They're not going to do anything to you today. They're not. But they file that because they have a list. Barbados, yes. Jamaica, yes. Bahamas, no. March 2022. Why? Why? For the same reason, you just keep list. One day, when the bell tolls, they can toll for you. It's reality. So, you know, I the government of the Bahamas, that's its job. Its job is one of the most profound responsibilities of an independent state is having responsibility for its external affairs. The Bahamas had internal self-government before it had external self-government. The Bahamas could decide on its education policy, could decide on its immigration policy before it could decide on whether it would set up diplomatic relations with the United States of America. There was a time when it had to go through London to decide who it could have relations with. Okay? So where empires and imperial lords gave you the right to have internal self-government, they denied you the right to have the same governance with external bodies. That's how important they felt it was to them. And so now you have you have external self-governance. And so you have the responsibility to decide how you respond to deeds and things in the international community. And so Russia invades contrary to established international protocols and norms. And therefore, the world community looks to see how the players in the world community responds to that behavior. It is not about Russia and Ukraine alone. It's the principle of the matter that they are trying to get a sense of your subscription to or not. You're listening to Z Live and Zhivargo, Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
In relationship, we take pride in getting to know our clients. You have access to knowledgeable, approachable ambassadors and financial coaches so that we can recommend the best product for you. At Fidelity, we care about you. From your financial health to your physical health, we can relate to you because we're just like you. Come and start your relationship banking experience with us today. Visit us online at fidelitygroup.com. Visit any of our branches in Nassau or Grand Bahama, or phone 356-7764 in Nassau, or 352-6676 for Freeport. Fidelity, we're good for you.
Babe, you moshed the car?
I ain't moshed the car. The lady who ran into me moshed the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. RSABahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
One thing there is no debate about is that PTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your PTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to PTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with PTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand.
My Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. If you want to call us, please feel free to do so on any of the following numbers, 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text also on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We're talking about Russia's interest in the country and the couple of billion dollars in assets, the central bank says. That's billion, not M, but billion, says exist here. Not sanctioned assets, just Russian assets. We don't know what's sanctioned or not sanctioned. We have a text here. This text says, says, Mr. Laing, the Bahamas will always be caught with the USA when it comes to support. Don't forget, Mr. Minister was caught up with that administration. It's not always, not always. I recall distinct occasions on which the Bahamas voted contrary to the US. I know in particular, Fred Mitchell was Minister of Foreign Affairs at the time it happened. I don't remember the issue offhand, so it's not always. But a Bahamian government would be naive, would be foolhardy, and I would say in some instances stupid, not to take account of American interest when it makes decisions. I didn't say to go and vote with the Americans all of this. I said, would be stupid not to. Because whether you like it or not, your fate is inextricably tied to the fate of the United States of America. That's just the nature of your current economic circumstances and social circumstances. You are very tied, very integrated into the American prospects and fortunes. And as goes theirs, so goes yours. And if they want to sink, they are able to do so. And so, yes, Bahamian governments will take account of what America's thoughts are, views are, and positions are on many things. Need it vote exactly with America all the time? No, it doesn't have to. But to not think about it, you'd be stupid not to. As we do, even with some European issues. Okay? This text says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. Great show. Very informative. Can you do a show on doctors trained in Cuba who are having issues getting jobs in the Bahamas? But the Bahamas government is hiring doctors and nurses from Cuba. Thank you. Yeah, it's a good something to raise for sure. I know the situation actually quite well. Quite well. I've had to deal with young Bahamians who trained in Cuba and cannot now, it seems, at least on the occasions when I spoke to them, find themselves working here. This text is Mr. Laing, great show. This information is important when a person is getting married because I could put my money and assets in a trust so if things don't work out, my fiance don't get one dime from me. Thank you so much for the information. See why I like your show, you educate. Wow. Boy, I hope your fiance never figure out that you. Mr. Laing, India, serious. They sanctioned Russia like everyone else. And then when Russia could not sell their oil, India went and bought it for a reduced price. What would have happened if we did the same thing? Buy the oil on a reduced price. I don't know. I don't know how to buy. I don't know how to buy this. I don't know. I don't know how that works. I don't know. You know, it's just not just buying oil. You know, you don't just go and buy the stuff. You know, you got to buy it. You have to have it transshipped and all that kind of stuff. That's why we use entities that we have a relationship with that can take care of all these matters too. You know, so I don't know though. I don't know how it works. Mr. Laing, we can sanction Russian assets all we like. When the Russian side, I hope we can take it. Yeah, those are the consequences for doing things on occasion. So what are you saying? So you're saying, so just be scared and don't do anything because you think America can't do anything to you? Really? You think America can't cripple you? It's only the Russians who could do it? Really? Because America doesn't tend to be in this way a bad actor. I said in this way, a bad actor. You think it's only Russia to be scared of? Boy, y'all really, y'all better wake up and smell the coffee on planet Earth. Yeah. Wake up and smell the coffee. Let me tell you something. There are many states in this world I don't want to get on their radar, right? I do not. Because what ain't on you will be made about you, right? I want you to know on top of that list for me is the United States of America. Y'all must think America's a joke, right? A joke. Just because Russia flashes its willingness to do things, and America don't flash it the way you think the Russians do it, you really think that it's the Russians you have to be scared of? Okay, bro. Scared I'd wake up for you. Yeah, I'd wake up for you. I have no idea. And y'all who love all this American technology that you are all your business all up on, all this Russian tech, all this U.S., you're going to the U.S. to buy your food, you're going to the U.S. to buy all your clothes, you're going to the U.S. to buy all your furniture, you're going to the U.S. to buy all your TV, all your phones, and it's the Russians you're scared of? But I want, tell me if these people them serious, please. Tell me if they understand, my friend. I'm saying things. You could wait all you want. Say, I'm waking. I smell the coffee, Mr. Laing. Check to see who has the most nuclear arms. No, no. Who has it? No. First of all, let me tell you something. This is what you call ignorance. I can be honest with you. I ain't gonna lie to you, right? This is ignorance. That's like saying, who has the most nuclear arms? So let me ask you a question. Say you have 10 guns and a fella have a machine gun. Does it matter that you have 10 guns if he shoots you first? Listen, in the nuclear arms race, it's the end result is what we call mutual self-destruction. There ain't gonna be no, the U.S. ain't had as much nuclear weapons, so they couldn't do Russia's bad. I'm talking nonsense. Once you see a nuclear weapon is launched by any of those guys, we are all done. We are done. So wake up and smell more coffee. Let nobody hear you say that again about who have more. In a nuclear war, we are all done. Done. People, don't let nobody fool you with that nonsense, yeah? You are not serious. Not serious. You think America and Russia want to get in a nuclear war? Boy, my brother, once that happens, we are all done. So read some more. Read up on the word mutual self-destruction, the words mutual self-destruction, and understand that concept. Because anybody running around going, China, the Russians have more nuclear weapons than the Americans, and think that means something, absolutely has no clue what a nuclear weapon is. Not a clue. Not a clue. Not a clue. First of all, when you launch a nuclear weapon, you can see it coming. But if I see it coming in my direction, I can launch mine and yours. Then what? If I launch 10 nuclear weapons in your direction, you launch 10 in my direction, you ain't got to worry about the rest of us. We're done. Absolute nonsense. But I'm going to keep trying. Keep trying. So anyways, we're going to take a break for news, ladies and gentlemen. Again, we got Russian interest here. We can't just say it's bad because it's Russian. We don't do that. That's just nonsense. It's just that some entities and persons of Russian, the Russian designation have been sanctioned. Who those are, we don't know here in the Bahamas. We're going to take a break for news, ladies and gentlemen. And when we come back, we'll continue our discussion. We'll be back after the news break. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. If you want to give us a call on the show today, the numbers to do so are 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259, that's 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796, that's 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043, that's 439-3043. This text says, Mr. Laing, don't you think government should take a leading role in sanctions on Russia? A leading role? What do you mean a leading role? How does the government, Bahamas government, take a leading role on that? I don't quite understand. But the Bahamas government has already issued instructions to its financial institutions not to do business with sanctioned Russian entities and businesses. So in effect, it is imposing a sanction already. I don't know what a leading role is, because Bahamas is not that global player. You know, you have United States and them already leading the way in sanctions. They can certainly be more impactful on Russian entities, persons, and businesses than we could ever be. So you do what you could do within the limits of your own power, you know? And I think that that's, for what I could see, what's happening. And so we'll have to see. I was listening to Minister. We have a caller on the line, sorry. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
How are you doing?
Hey, I'm radio man, and yourself?
I'm fine, man. I can try to speak slowly today, and I gonna ask you a couple of questions. I can put you in some history.
Okay.
I know your background, your educational background, finance, commerce, banking, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm.
But as I listen, you know, and when you talk, that's the first show I call today. I didn't call it right now, I don't want to, because sometimes I listen, particularly if I visit you in the smaller things.
Mm.
And, you know, our text wrote to something, and you know, and see, my thing is this, right? According to our constitution, freedom of speech, freedom of association, freedom of everything, that don't mean you have to agree to poison. Everybody thinks we've been people dumb, stupid, and homophobic. I say this thing, let me get to my point.
Okay.
The first nation in the world ever drop atomic bomb on the nation is who?
The United States?
Thank you very much. Russia have nuclear weapons, Britain, and all these countries.
Mm-hmm.
You know why they have these things for Biden to protect themselves and their people?
Mm-hmm.
See, Saddam Hussein didn't have no nuclear weapon, neither Gaddafi.
No.
All they've been talking, more murders like both being. Talk, and anger. Mm-hmm. North Korea got nuclear weapons. But mm-hmm. You see, they ain't fooling with them, right? Iran trying to get their own with the help of Russia. See, people can understand.
We think North Korea.
China still buying Russian oil, and people still buying Russian oil, you know.
But we think
Russian and America, I think the only two countries who have to answer the Hague. Now, I don't know if people understand what I mean by the Hague. See, a lot of people, they call the talk show, they know the Jesus Christ thing and every Jesus Christ thing. When Graham talking, I listen. When my cousin C. Allen Johnson talking, I listen. When people talking, I listen. Mm. I don't have to ask about everything. I don't let people tell me what to say. I do my research. Like, I didn't know I love you. I love all my baby people. Because if I was in that room, I'm saying my people, and our people clapping, he called all of them and said, but domino. What they mean to me, I do construction and junk and other things. What they mean to me? But see, my thing is this. My God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, with all America, all these nuclear weapons, God will stop. Because see, God took 6 days to create this world, his world. And before he let Americans, the oppressors, and the British, and the Portuguese, and the Spanish, and all these people destroy his world, he will come and put and make it stop. You see, people understand because I had to read history, read and see who the conquerors are. There's some white nations. They rape Africa. They rape the Middle East. India told Britain several years ago, man, I got over 3 billion people, you know. I got my nuclear weapon, and they have the ease off. See, my thing is, blank. See, you was a smart young man, everything. Let's be balanced, man, and let's respect our people, man. And that's all I got to say on the matter.
Okay. I have to confess, I'm not quite sure what the point was there. I'm not sure. I'm not sure what the point is there. You know, let me see if I can help you out with something. This before, and I think that anyone who's heard me since the time I said it will concede that I'm not doing it. Okay, let me tell you on. I don't go to war for my opinions anymore. I don't. I express my view, my point of view. If it's just an opinion, and you express yours, and I could disagree with it vehemently, but that's all it is. It's a disagreement with it vehemently. But let me tell you, I want to tell you all something about your own psyche. This is what is happening. If somebody says to you that something you're saying is ignorant, the reason why you get offended at that is because you probably believe you're ignorant yourself. It's not because they offended you. The offense comes because you yourself are sitting in doubt about what you know. Because if someone says to me, Zhivargo, you know, you're ignorant about electrical work, I'm going to say to them, you're doggone right. Because all I'll do is electrocute myself if I go ahead fooling around with that. That's why when I have electrical work to do, I call one of the best friends I have on planet Earth. Right? Similarly, I had a door at my home, and I got all the material, and I went on YouTube even to look to see if I could do it myself. But in the end, I decided, no, man, this is not my area of expertise. I'm not ignorant about this. So I went and I got another one of my best friends in the world, and he did it for me. Did a great job, right? So your offense at being called ignorant is nothing but ego on your part. It's your own arrogance that makes you react that way to it. Right? Because any human being who has no knowledge about something cannot be offended by being called ignorant about that thing. Now, let me tell you what I'm not going to do. And I heard Brother Juan trying to talk to you about this before. If you call my show and you sound to me like you ain't have a clue about what you're talking about, do not expect me to pander to you. I'm not going to do that. Okay? I'm not going to do it. All right? So if you get offended about that, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that you get offended, but that's on you. That's on your own ego. That's not on me. That's on your own insecurity. That's on your own sense of mediocrity. It's not on me called ignorant about things of which I'm ignorant, because I am ignorant about a whole lot of things. A whole lot of things, right? My mother taught me to cook. And you know why she taught me to cook? Because I knew I was ignorant about cooking, so I listened to the woman. And she has a great cooking hand. Okay? So I really wasn't understanding my friend's point about treating people like you're ignorant. If you sound ignorant, it's probably because you're ignorant. That's the reality, right? If somebody asks me today, how many nuclear weapons exist in the world? I will tell them I am ignorant about that fact. I do not know. Now, if I call you ignorant to be malicious, right, to put you down, that's a different story. But this little sensitivity you all have, let me tell you something. I don't know a lot of other people's cultures. But my interaction with my own culture is that we have no problem spewing out our opinions as if it's a fact and then getting offended when people call us out on our ignorance. We have no problem. Too many of us have no difficulty with that. All right? And that's something that we need to check because it isn't good for us. We got a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Hi, go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Oh, hi. Good afternoon, Mr. Laing. How are you?
Good afternoon. How are you doing?
Yeah, right here. This is a good show, what you have going on here.
Thank you.
Right up your alley because you're the economics and finance person.
A little bit, yes.
Yeah, but I think this issue was happening in Russia here. This really concerns all Bahamian citizens, you know? Because, to be honest with you, like you said, you know, everybody isn't well-versed on everything, you know? We're all ignorant about some things, you know? But my thing is with the war, right? I wonder why it had to come to the point where Ukraine had to fight this war, because if they're close to Russia, if they used to be Russia, a part of the Soviet Union at one point in time, then, you know, why, if you see, I know they're part, they should be, they're part of the NATO countries, right?
So, Ukraine?
Yeah, Ukraine.
No,
I think they're not, in fact,
that's one of the things Russia is trying to prevent.
Oh, but I thought they signed it in 2020 somewhere.
No. Ukraine is
still it's saying that. Anyway, I guess you can probably look it up. And so, what I'm saying though, if they're not a part of the NATO body and the U.S. is giving them equipment to fight against Russia, my thing is, you're coming close to the border. You're upsetting some persons who are just behind me, whom I have. Used to be a part of whom people in my country have children with relationship with. That is a bit too close for comfort. And instead of making the decision and taking the choice to say, you know what, I'm going to listen to what you're saying, even though I'm not a part of you, you're not going to be helping me, and I'm going to be ready to fight war against these people. That's a choice he made, as opposed to saying, listen, y'all are so close here. Why are you here? Could you step back away from this border, y'all a bit too close, and I don't want no problems. I don't want to lose my people. I don't want any war, because that's what's happened. Oh, look at people, mass exodus out of the country, who ain't dying. It's sad.
But man, let me tell you something.
Uh-huh.
The way you can prove that NATO, that Ukraine is not a part of NATO, is by the fact that America and NATO felt no compulsion to go in and protect them. Because a member of NATO once attacked, there is a provision in their agreement that requires
them to go in and protect. But I just looked, unless online is wrong, because I said, let me double check.
No. What online is saying, what they are saying online is Ukraine joined NATO's Enhanced Opportunity Partner Interoperability Program.
Oh, okay. See, we're learning here. See, I didn't know that. Yeah, but still, I mean, well, if like I say all the more, if I know I am not a part of you, I am not going to let you come near me to wage war against somebody behind me, and then me and my people get caught up in the crossfire. And then, furthermore, I'm not going to join up with you to listen to you to say, oh, give me arms, give me weapons, and get people making cocktail and... rudimentary. You know what I mean? Compared to the Russian army.
That's because what you're not doing is, you know, countries in the world, they also recognize something called precedence.
Uh-huh.
And so they are thinking, okay, you let Russia do that on that occasion.
Uh-huh.
What's next?
Yeah.
What's next?
Okay, well, I understand. So
if you don't take a stand today, what's next? And then who else is next?
That's true. Is China
going into Taiwan next?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the thing is, would you not look at how well equipped you are to go up against such a mighty nation? So you have people who come in out of ballet dancing, taking up arms, training impromptu to go up against somebody who has been in an army seasoned warriors. I mean, how could you know that's like really a David against Goliath type of competition here. And see, like how you say, okay, you
ma'am,
say.
Ma'am, slow, ma'am, I need you to slow down for me, please. I really do. I need you to slow down because you're overwhelming me right now with who's David and who's Goliath?
No, I'm just using a scenario.
I know, but you can't know. But we're talking Ukraine and Russia now. So
okay, so what I'm saying, okay, this is what I mean. Okay, what I mean by that is the Russian, the Ukraine army, like, say, for example, like I said, there were persons who were, they had a beauty contest, and she's now picked up the arms. She's fighting. They had persons who were involved with their ballet school. We are now getting ready, who are fighting towards picking up arms, who are untrained novice people. That's what I'm talking about, you see, who are Ukrainians. And now they decided, hey, I'm going to fight for my country. Normal, everyday citizens. And they're going up against persons who are Russian. They ain't selling no civilians. They're selling seasoned soldiers to fight against these people. You see what I'm saying? So it's an unfair battle. That's what I'm saying. And then what I'm saying, another thing is like how you, I think you was talking a little about it earlier. If China, right, decides to say, hey, wait a minute now. People are placing sanctions on Russia. They get some nice steel or oil. And because they have so much sanctions, they might be willing to sell me something what they were selling for $10. Instead, they'll sell it to me for $5. Will I see a little interest here? You know, who's to stop them? Because they're a superpower. America has 300 and something million. China has how much? 1 point something billion people. And their army is very powerful, very strong. So they are a superpower. If they join up with Russia and they both share, you know, can help each other out with common interests, Matt, you know, it could be serious. It could be serious.
Thank you. So, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate you. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate it. Okie dokie. We have a text here. Text says, the point I'm getting in this discourse is we cannot cut off our nose to spoil our face. If we don't side with the people who feed us, then we leave ourselves open to numerous unknown consequences that could potentially sink this country. I would say that that's a consideration. That's a consideration, surely, for sure. There's no question with that. And that's a reasonable human being would do that. Says, oh man, this caller needs a breath to breathe. It's also overwhelming me. I have to tell you, I've never had that experience before. That was a unique experience for me. You know, but the point she was making about these Ukrainian untrained military people is a point that she probably misses from history. You know, anybody remembers what happened to the very powerful, dominating Russian army in Afghanistan? You remember how long Russia was in Afghanistan and basically had to leave because they couldn't find an army? Right? They were not as superior in militarily speaking as to the Russians, but they couldn't beat them. How about the United States and Vietnam? What the United States ended up doing in the end? Declaring war and leaving, not because they had won, but because they couldn't win. They were in an unending fight, right? So I'm sorry. Sometimes, as one military genius says, boy, an impassioned people fighting for sovereignty can outflank an overwhelming army fighting only for pride. Right? But so I don't know. Many countries have shown, boy, they will rag you. They'll rag you. And you see what Ukraine is doing now. I mean, Russia is not having the time it thought it would have. Right? talking to Brother Warren told me he was telling you all out. People call, and I assume that they should know or expect them to know. And he doesn't expect them to know. So he doesn't get us irritated. No. Really, I can tell you what really, really gets me. What really gets me is when people speak about things they don't know, you try to help them with information, and then they persist in their not knowing. Very doggedly. That gets me. But it don't get me as much anymore. I'm trying to... I've truly discovered that it's better to be calm. for your own self, not for y'all, not for anybody else, not to please nobody, but it's just better for you to be calmer. Sometimes you can be impassioned, but save it. Save it for an occasion that really counts. You know? So, I was saying, I heard Minister Harkidis, he was speaking in the Senate about trying to do something about inflation. Really, inflation is, for the time being, a issue in the world, right? In the United States, in the Bahamas, in the world. It's gas prices are high, food prices are high, right? Are getting higher. And we had to do something about that. But structurally speaking, prices in the Bahamas have tended to be relatively high. Despite the fact that we have to import most of our food, I think that it's all excuse making that that the prices are as high as they tend to be, even though I can see that if you look at the cost of fuel and therefore electricity, and you look at the shipping expenses associated with bringing stuff here, et cetera, I still believe that our prices reflect a crude calculation that most of the prices in the Bahamas are using to kind of price things. And by and large, Bahamians don't have the luxury of going and not many Bahamians of just flying in someplace else and somebody else for cheaper. The ones who can fly away, who can go away every couple of months and do their shopping, they get to kill it. And they can do that. So if we want to do something with prices in the Bahamas, we got to be radical, right? We have to be radical. And the people who now benefit from the structure of the Bahamian economy the way it is, ain't gonna like the radical thing you have to do to, in the long term, have a better pricing circumstance for Bahamian consumers. They're not. They won't be. They won't like it. But I'm going to tell you what that long-term strategy is for dealing with prices when I come back. You're listening to Z-Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds. You can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic, your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us Yeah, today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers to do so are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. So I was talking about the minister's desire and comments on trying to do something about inflation. And as I said, this particular inflation issue is really, most believe, a temporary issue. We're not going to have this escalation in prices continuing over a sustained basis. But structurally speaking, in the Bahamas, we have had an issue with higher prices than the heinous thing they ought to be paid. And so I was saying, I'm going to talk to you about what the strategy long-term is for dealing with those prices, but I don't think it's going to be, so not too many people want to hear it, right? But I'll give it to you. So, number one, the government of the Bahamas should move duties altogether, bring them to an irreducible level, right? Get rid of custom duties as a source of revenue, as a significant source of revenue, so that maybe we end up with custom duties around 5-10% on average, really, right? Now, that's in the short term, that could give you some relief, but in the long term, it'll give you a lot more relief. Now you say, but these people ain't gonna reduce the prices when you reduce the duty like that. That's not the whole story yet. That's just one component of it. You'll see how this comes into play later on. You say, well, where's the government gonna get the revenue from? Find other forms of taxation, more progressive forms of taxation, right? I could say income taxes, but I don't want to scare anybody and get anybody upset with me. I don't care what it is. Find a more progressive form of taxation, right? Just kill the custom duties, you know, as a source of revenue. That puts a cap on, or it can slow down, or it can better cause pricing in the country. That's one thing. Now, all these things have been done together now. The other thing is, oh boy, let Bahamians go and work franchises with them big stores abroad and compete with these companies, because competition is what you use to get consumers' best price and quality. Competition. Let them have to compete with other people. You say, oh, but that means that some of our companies will go out of business. If they're not efficient, if they're not price ready, they're buying from abroad. They are buying from abroad. Why can't you? Why they're going abroad to shop for you? What's the problem with you being able to buy the stuff for yourself by bringing abroad here? That's what you do with your tourists. I said, I told you it wasn't going to be popular. I'm sure I'm going to get bashed. But you know what is funny? You know what is funny? You let the Bahamas government say today that there could only be one grocery store in the Bahamas from now on. Owned by a Bahamian, mind you, but no other Bahamian could be a grocery store. Watch and see what outcry you would get. You let the Bahamian government say today there could only be one gas station in the Bahamas, owned by a Bahamian, mind you, but only one. You watch and see what outcry you would get today. Huh? You know what they say? Oh, but you against competition. You get, yes. But are you not against competition when you stop Bahamians from being able to access what they can access cheaper somewhere else? Oh, competition only good when it's good for you, but it ain't good when it's good for somebody else. Competition and consumer advocacy are great ways to take prices and quality in the direction of the consumer's benefit. And we are not going to do anything about pricing in the Bahamas if we don't rev up competition in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Ask the media. Okay, so all the Guardian Radio and all these other media have to compete against each other, including competing with the government. That could happen. Right? That could happen. And some of them cry about it, say, listen, this ain't fair. But that could happen, right? Bamboo Jack got to compete against Kentucky Fried Chicken, Popeyes, and them. That could happen. Hey, ain't nothing wrong with that. But other people, they got to be protected from competition against international players. That's not okay. I mean, like we folks, we are fooling ourselves in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. We are living a lie. We are living a lie. And we are living a lie for a narrow group of people to benefit maximally from that lie. That's the reality. I'm not hating on them because if that's, they took advantage of a circumstance that was structured. I don't blame them. But that doesn't mean we have to keep doing it. There's a new breed of Bahamians. If given the opportunity to have and forge alliances with international players, they can bring a whole new dynamic to the Bahamian economic scene. And the pricing and the quality would be better for the Bahamian public. And let me explain something else to y'all. A lot of these people you see who you're calling Bahamians who own these things, who are being protected, they are also people who have alliances with foreign concerns, either on the basis of capital or some other arrangement to help them be in the position that they are in. They won't tell anybody and don't let me talk your business. So we are fooling ourselves. And we are running around with all of these nationalistic political arguments to favor a narrow group of people whose interests are protected by the Bahamas being the way it is today. We think that's okay. Well, okay. I mean, I can't say anything. I can't say, you know. I'm talking about prices. Competition does something with prices, right? If your competition is reducing prices because they're aggressive and rigorous, you got to do something in response thereto. If people have choices, not one and two choices, if they have more choices and not collusive choices and not oligarchical choices, when people have multiple choices in a dynamic and a literally competing environment, then something got to break for the consumer. This text says, I agree with you. Mighty first world countries do not always win. It depends on how far the logistics of the country is from the occupied country. True. Since the US did not win in Afghanistan, nor Iraq, Russia did not win in Afghanistan as well. And in both instances, superpowers did not win over small countries. Right? So those are great examples for sure. This text is when people just be pulling stuff out of the air. It's a difficulty, but history informs us that some people just ain't seeing things. That's true. That's why I'm trying to let my blood pressure get up and when, you know. So get rid of custom duties at the border, right? Get rid of, open up the place for competition. Let them come in. Let them flood in. Banks. Let Bahamians go. Find financing abroad. Ah, boy. Think things will change? Steck says, good afternoon, bro. You're on point with the price and competition. We need this to drive prices down. Keep dropping the knowledge to woke the Bahamian people. I'm glad I get one person to agree with me. Honestly, I'm just telling you, right? There's no other way. You think the players who are here now Forget inflation for the moment. When inflation is subsiding, do you think that they're going to reduce prices for you? Or do you think that an environment of stiff competition might help you get that done? Right? Like right now, we look at oil prices, right? The government of the Bahamas collects a hell of a lot of money off of fuel prices, right? We ought to shift from putting our fuel prices, our taxes on fuel, right? And shift to something else more reliable and progressive. Take it off so that you don't get that upfront price and cost to the consumer. Take the price. Listen to me. So you might say, Zhivargo, when you were there, why you didn't do these things? First of all, I can be honest with you. I would not have even dreamt of this then, because I had not been steeped in the dynamics of our commercial and economic structure as I am to be, right? So I would not have, the thought wouldn't even have entered my mind to do so, right? So if that's a quick criticism of me, but I take it. It hit me with it, it's mine. You were ignorant, Zhivargo, then, right? But I can tell you one thing, knowing what I know today, if you like me or love me, hate me or don't like me, same old knowledge still persists, that the people who price the stuff for you today are going to reduce prices for you tomorrow? Or do you think that competition may lead them to one or two things? Either reduce their price or at the very least reduce the rate at which they increase the price to you so that in the long term you benefit. Which one do you think? Do you think by simply taking the price and no matter what they do to you, just buying and buying and buying, that it's going to get better for you? Or do you think by saying hell to the no, I'm not going to buy it, and large numbers of us are not going to buy it, will it not do something in the way of reducing the price and or slowing the increase down over time for you? Competition and consumer advocacy are the most powerful ways of doing that. And there are many players in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas who are satisfied with the protecting structures of this economy, that they are not going to face stiff competition, and therefore they can carry on with business as usual. Let me ask you all a question. Let's suppose it cost you $20 Nassau to Florida. What do you think would happen with the stores in the Bahamas? Don't tell me, that can't happen. That's not the point. Do the exercise. Imagine it. $20 to get from here to Florida. Tell me what would happen. Tell me what would happen within a year's time of that being possible. I want somebody to text me and tell me. We can take a break. When we come back, I can read your text. What would happen? $20 to get from Nassau to Florida. What do you think would happen to the source in New Providence? You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing. We'll be back.
We believe in relationship banking. We take pride in getting to know our clients. You have access to knowledgeable, approachable ambassadors and financial coaches so that we can recommend the best product for you. At Fidelity, we care about you. From your financial health to your physical health, we can relate to you because we're just like you. Come and start your relationship banking experience with us today. Visit us online at fidelitygroup.com. Visit any of our or phone 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 for Freeport.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Child, Johnny Mo's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pulled my phone out, pull up the Royal Star Insurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep, sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of
app. You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today.
Is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. Listen, it is now 3:48. I feel like I just started this show. This text said, boy, say $20 from Nassau to Florida. Say I would duck work on my lunch break to go to Walmart and Cheesecake Factory. This person says, if it was $20 to get to Florida, all the Bahamian businesses will either drop their prices and adopt to the market competition or go to business. Exactly right. That is exactly right. That's exactly my point. That's exactly right. So what is the key to getting the prices changed, to getting the prices increases slowed down? It's competition. Say, if Trump is president, we wouldn't need to imagine Biden is a disgrace. Oh, my Lord, God of mercy on my soul. Well, the price was $20 when Biden was in. You could get the bombs from Florida for $20. But my texter has the point. They have the point. The point is that Bahamians' accessibility to cheaper prices is what will cause others who charge them higher prices to respond accordingly, right? And the dynamism of that can be helpful to the economy broadly because people save more, they have more cash on hand, they can do more things, they have more economic activity. You might get some shift out of some sectors into more sectors, but ultimately it's better for consumers to be able to afford things. It's better, not worse. It's better. And you know what? For the people, for some of these businesses who get mad at me and say, oh, what you talking about, et cetera, let me ask you all a question. If you didn't believe better pricing was important, why do you offer discounts? Why do you offer sales? Why do you do that? If your pricing reflects what you have to charge, why do you give discounts? Why do you give sales? How can you give sales if you don't have some space? Why do you give discounts? Why do you give stamps and stuff like that? Why do you do that? Why do you have giveaways? Why do you do that? You do it because you're saying people respond to lower prices. That's what you're doing. That's what you're saying. So if people could have better prices on a sustained basis, wouldn't they be spending more? I mean, come on. This isn't rocket science. This isn't Zhivargo's Economics 400. This is none of that. This is just common sense. Listen to me, folks. Let me tell you something. Think about it, right? So some of the people get mad with me and they say, well, you are advocating competition, foreign competition against our own companies. Well, let me ask you a question. Where are your companies buying the products from? They're buying it from foreigners. And what do they do when they go to the foreign places? They shop. They go and see which foreigner is offering them the best price. What? Yeah, they don't come to you. They go and find out which foreigners are offering the best price. If prices wasn't the issue and if they didn't want you to be concerned about prices, why do they not buy up all the price, the stuff that the local Bahamians have, notwithstanding the prices are higher than the ones they could get from abroad? Why they don't buy up the Bahamian farmers' chicken, the Bahamian farmers' vegetables, and buy all of them up since the prices don't matter? They don't do it. They go to Panama, they go to Brazil, they go to Mexico, they go to China, they go all over the world looking for lower prices. Why? Because they want to make more profits or not. Where you want to make more, blame you for that. You should maximize your profits, but you don't want Bahamian consumers to maximize their savings. They get to be better off at better prices, just as you get to be better off at better prices. So don't give me the sad story now that, oh, you know, everybody wants to be better off. And you know what Gerald Ford, you know what Ford said, not Gerald Ford, the maker of the Ford cars, you know what he said? He said, I'm going to pay my workers well, because if I pay my workers well, they can afford my cars. He had a comprehensive prism through which he was looking at his own fortune. Well, isn't the Bahamian consumer better off with spending, going to spend more? You think they're going to buy more stuff when the doggone, my mother told me the other day, she went to buy something and the price went from $15 to $30. And you think she's going to buy more? You know what she said? She says, I'm not buying that anymore. It was lamb chops. Right? That's not rocket science. We've improved the pricing structure in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Competition is the way to do it. And that competition isn't going to come from at home. It's going to come from abroad. And just like everybody else gets to compete with foreign competition, like these local food makers like Bamboo Shack, just like they have to compete with foreign competition. And just as our local banks owned by Bahamians have to compete with foreign banks, and just like young Bahamian professionals in certain fields have to compete with other foreign professionals, we should open the competition up and let everybody compete against the same kinds of people. And then the Bahamian public will be better off that way. So good afternoon, sir. Keep talking. We're listening to you very carefully then. We will respond to the government. This text says, a lot of money of fuel government makes it is correct. What do you suggest they do for fuel retailers who now, because of the price of gas, spend 91 cents of each dollar made? No exaggeration to fuel. I think that the government of the Bahamas should just let the gas business be free flowing, right? Take the price control off. It's antiquated now. But again, though, it has to be in an environment where there's open competition. Open competition. If any of us faces competition, should face competition. Nonsense. If any of us face competition, all of us should face competition. Right? There's no special group of Bahamians. There's no Bahamian who's more Bahamian than the other Bahamian. Nonsense. Just because you're in a particular business, you get to be protected, the other Bahamians get to be exposed. That's nonsense. That's not equity. That's not fair. That's not just. And it isn't even effective. Right? So all we do is we keep protecting ourselves into these mediocrities. Right? And it's not good for any of us. Yeah, I know. Get me fired. Yeah. Tell them you don't like me. Tell them I shouldn't be on the air. Yeah. Okay. Fine. No problem at all. No problem. I've been there before. I've been there where I lost jobs because people said, well, we don't like what he's saying. I've been there before. I lost a $120,000 a year contract because people said they didn't like what I was saying. Get him, get fire him. And they did fire me. Yeah. I'm going to be afraid to say what I know to be true, factual? You really think so? Okay, carry on. Says, good afternoon. Is your view of embracing competition from abroad sufficiently liberal for you to press that argument on behalf of North American life insurance companies, particularly those that sell whole life, team life, and health life insurance coverage? Yes. Competition is competition, right? I mean, it's competition. And like, again, I know this isn't going to be popular with everybody, maybe even some of my friends, maybe even some of my colleagues, right? But the principle is the same. And I'd be a hypocrite to try and apply the principle differently, right? Mind you, I don't have any power to make this happen, so I'm only expressing a point of view. Again, I'm not going to go to war for it, you know? But, you know, if the truth has consequences, then let them flow to me. But we have to stop pretending that tinkering around the edges is going to fix something. Right? Let's be real. I'm not talking about fixing inflationary pressures today. Right? I'm not talking about those. Those pressures are exogenous to the Bahamas. I'm talking about structuring the Bahamian economy differently so that it favors the consumer more than it does today. And there's only one way to do that. Consumer advocacy and competition. That's the potent ways to do it. And moving some of the upfront costs to consumers that the government applies by virtue of its own taxing policies. And I'm telling you that those efforts would reverberate throughout the Bahamian economy. BPL would be better off. Businesses would be better off. Bahamian consumers would be better off. Even if we move, again, taxes off of our tickets to fly into the Bahamas, we would do ourselves a service. Now, I know that the airport structured their financing tied to those taxes, but we could structure that differently. Anyway, you all have a great day. You've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. If I'm here tomorrow, I'll talk to you then. God bless. We'll talk to you tomorrow.
Take a stand, take a stand.